Sunday service. It's so great to have you all here with us today. And whether it's your first time or your 500th, it's great to see you. Just a little reminder before we get started, we are running Ignite and Rock Solid, our kids groups today. So if your kids are involved in that, please make sure that you get Ignite or Rock Solid written on the end of their names and we can put them into the correct groups. Today we are going to be looking at the book of Matthew in the Bible. I'm just going to read a little bit for you now to focus our hearts and minds in preparation for worship. And the crowds that went before him, and that followed him were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that we can all be here together today, even though we are apart. I pray, Lord, that you will prepare our hearts for worship, that we will be ready to hear what you have to say to us through Greg today. And we pray, Lord, that we will be wholly obedient to you in all that we do. Amen. Great. So now we're going to move on to our first song, which is 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his soul. Strength is failing, in draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship Him. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name, I'll worship your holy name, God, I'll worship your holy name.
Big and great God, who sent his son to die for us. Lord, I know I don't revel in that very often. I do forget that day to day, Lord, but I just thank you for days that we have friends and community who remind us of who you are, Lord, which is a God who's so big, powerful and mighty and majestic. Lord, you created everything that we're living in. You have a plan that was written in the past and is written for our future as well. So pray now that we are trusting in our salvation in you. Give us strength in areas where we need strength. Lord, I pray now for the health of the church. I pray for those struggling with mental health in the congregation. Pray that they're feeling supported. Lord, they know where to go to speak to someone. Lord, when they're needing words of encouragement and reassurance. For those concerned with anything to do with the virus, with restrictions releasing, maybe those are struggling about jobs. Maybe kids are back at school, but also finding that hard, and maybe some are absolutely loving it. Lord, we're all coming in today from different areas. So Lord, I pray for health and just for safety within our church. Lord, keep everyone close to you. We do thank you, Lord, that kids have been able to get back to church. We're just praying now that any changes in regulations won't cause any spikes in the numbers. We trust your plan in that, Lord, even when it's hard to say so, because it's sometimes difficult to see beyond the next week or the next month. But we want to trust you, and we come before you humbly today for that. Lord, I want to lift up the life groups that happen each week. I just thank you for the chance to be reconnecting, looking further into your word and encouraging each other. Keep the church alive in this way, Lord, and supporting each other. And we give that over to you completely. I pray also ahead of the Easter service that's coming up. Pray for the tech, for each person involved. Pray for as well the kids' Easter, Lord, as there's more tech and more going on YouTube. Lord, things happen that we don't always know about, but I lift that up to you, and you've got a plan as that goes out. Pray as well for Brackley, pray for the community of people who just don't know you yet. I thank you that this church is based here, Lord, where we can be reaching out to each person, and each family here, each person in school and work will know of friends who might be keen to talk about it, Lord, to be talking about you. Just pray for boldness and invitations to the Easter service there as well. We trust that completely to you. In your name, Lord, we pray all this in your name. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Thanks, Kara. Before we continue, Greg is just going to share a little reflection on this past year.
Thanks, Sarah. Good afternoon, everybody. Lovely to see you all. Do you know, it's a year. It's a year since we've been meeting on Zoom. A year ago was our first full Zoom service. A lot's happened, isn't it, in that year? I was thinking about this morning, and as I was filling out the census, I thought, how do I view this year as a church family? What does this last year look like? I guess I started pretty despondently thinking, gosh, we've been online, it's been hard. But then as I've looked back, it's been with actually immense gratitude at what the Lord has done. Let me just take you through what this last year as a family, as a church family, has looked like for us. In Ephesians chapter 6, when we're thinking about praying, it says this, "And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep praying for all the Lord's people." Since we started lockdown last year, we have started daily prayers. Sandra has taken the lead in writing those daily prayers, and many of you have contributed to that over the year. What a wonderful thing that's been. We've started weekly prayer meetings on a Wednesday morning, which has been a great addition to our family life, making our foundation solid in praying to our Father. And we've had prayer in services every Sunday. Now, that seems like normative to us now, but it wasn't before we started this period. Then as you think about how we've encouraged each other over the last year, in Hebrews it says this, "Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promises faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." It's been really encouraging, hasn't it, over this last year to see how we as a church have adapted to encouraging one another. This time last year, we did a 3-minute video vlog every day leading up to Easter. We have had children's versions of that and a lockdown 2 version of the morning vlogs over the last year. We've had ladies' coffee mornings. We've had life groups meeting online every week. We've had lots of individual care for each other. There's been literally hundreds of pastoral calls, one-to-ones, meetings, visits done by many of you to support one another over this last year. And we've been able to meet together like this. And we great thanks to Lauren for recording songs for us to be able to sing together, even though we can't be together. But we've also grown as a church. We have come as a church under the sound of the Bible. The Bible has taught us, even though we've been at home. In Colossians 1, it says this, "He is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ." Whether you're a child or whether you're an adult, that has been the aim. Do you know what? We've gone through 8 Bible books in this last year. We've had 10 guest speakers. We've looked at Ecclesiastes, Mark, Revelation, 2 Peter, 2 Timothy, Psalms. We've been around the world with guest speakers from Central Asia, India, Barbados, Kosovo, Sweden, the Netherlands and Wales. I know it's not quite around the world, but Wales counts, doesn't it? We've looked at Habakkuk. We've had a series on God is bigger than our doubt, our pain, death, anxiety. We've looked at Micah and then Matthew over the last couple of months. And Kids Church has run every week, Ignite, Rock Solid and Surge, to support our young people. There's lots to give thanks to God for as we've encouraged one another this year. But we've also reached out. It seems ridiculous to say it, but we have reached out as a church family this year, even though we've been in lockdown so often. 2 Timothy 2 talks about how are we to encourage one another and keep doing the work of the evangelist. Well, we've run Tesco Church. Remember that in the car park? What a great day that was. We've had Kids Explore, Messy Churches, Story Time, YouTube monthly services in the first part of the year, and pigsties up trees by lakes. We have a street evangelism team that have been out when we can onto the streets to share Jesus. We produced, along with other churches, a carol service which over 1,000 people accessed. We've had Explore Life, and we've given books at Christmas and now at Easter to the schools in Brackley. We have Follow the Star for people to engage with the good news of Jesus. Do you know there's 1,400 Easter books going out to the schools across Brackley in the next couple of weeks? Isn't that encouraging? But not only that, 2 Timothy also encourages us to keep our head in all situations and to discharge the duties of our ministry. And we've been able to run church this year in difficult circumstances. And great thanks to Louis for running all the finances for us, to Tara for working tirelessly coordinating church life whilst also updating behind the scenes our governance and safeguarding policies, to Alice for helping out behind the scenes. For the interns, remember Cam and Jenna chipping in all the way through to July, and now our new 6, not so new anymore, that have really helped update our website, help us run kids' activities, done lots to run the church behind the scenes. As a leadership team, we take really seriously what our role is in Acts chapter 20. Keep watch over yourselves and over the flock which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, who he bought with his own blood. Since the start of lockdown last year, instead of meeting monthly, we started to meet weekly to try and navigate the pandemic and the ever-changing landscape. And that happened for 45 weeks solidly. So it's been a real shift from the leadership team to pick up and run what's been going forward. We spent hours and hours discussing, praying, debating our future. We brought in people from outside the church to consult and to help us think through how to and where to move forward. And we've really used this time to crystallise our vision and focus so that we can take some bold steps as we move out of lockdown this summer. So there's loads and loads to give thanks for. It's been a really tough year. None of us imagined spending a year looking at each other on screens. It's been a really tough year. It's been a tough year in our families. It's been a tough year in our country. Yet we can look back and say the gospel is not chained. It's not chained. We've been encouraged and we've been able to encourage others in Jesus. What a wonderful hope that is. Coming up on Easter week, we're going to go for a week of morning videos to encourage you and focus your hearts for Easter. And on Easter Sunday at 9 a.m, we will launch, like the carol service, a short service that will go out on YouTube for people from churches across Brackley, but also for the wider community, pointing them to the great hope of a risen Lord Jesus. And then at 4 o'clock on Easter Sunday, we will meet back together for the first time for a family gathering at the Baptist Church at 4 o'clock on Easter Sunday. And then from then onwards on the Sundays, we will meet back live face to face. Now, we'll be different. It will be awkward to start with. There will be challenges, but what a joy that is, isn't it? To come back together and be able to meet live. During a kind of period of time, we'll also be offering an online access to that for those who are shielding or unable to come. But the aim is to move back to meeting live and encouraging one another together. So hopefully that encourages your hearts as you look back and as we look forward as a church family, that though it's been a year, we can be incredibly grateful for what the Lord has done in and through us. And I'm really grateful as I lead this church to look around this screen and see so many people who love Jesus and have been willing to really go the extra mile this year. So a huge thank you to you all as a family, as we've looked to reach this community with the good news of the gospel. Let me pray for us. Father, as we look back, it is with wonder at what you've done. The many people who have had access to find out about Jesus for the first time in lots of different ways, children and adults alike. Lord, for the way we've been able to keep going and keep encouraging each other and keep living out what you've encouraged us to do, to not stop, but to keep going and encouraging one another. As we look forward, Lord, it's hard to lay plans at the moment, so we do lay them before you and ask that you continue to guide us as we step forward as a church into the future. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Greg. Next up, we have a song that's got some fun actions. Jen's going to join me on the screen here to talk them through. It's just for the chorus, so I do hope that you all join in before Strikey leads us.
So it's called The Days of Elijah. And the chorus goes, "Behold, he comes, riding on a cloud, shining like the sun, at the trumpet's call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes." Great. Let's, Strikey, take it away.
Days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore, we are the voice in the desert, crying, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes." Days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming his flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as white in the world. We are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. And out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, at the trumpet call. Lift your voice, it's the year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's hill, salvation comes.
Very well entertained. Next up, Vicky is going to read for us today's passage, which is coming from Matthew's account of Jesus's life in the Bible. And while she reads, kids are going to go into their groups. Thanks, Vicky.
So I'll be reading from Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 to 17. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with a colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Say to daughter Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Jesus entered the temple courts and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. "It is written," he said to them, "My house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers." The blind and the lame came to him at the temple and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did and the children shouting in the temple courts, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant. "Do you hear what these children are saying?" they asked him. "Yes," replied Jesus. "Have you never read? From the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise." And he left them and went out of the city to Bethany, where he spent the night. Let's pray before Greg speaks to us. Father, thank you so much for the chance to gather here together as a church family. We thank you for the gift of your word, and we open our hearts to learn more about you today. We love to pray for Greg as he speaks from this passage, and we pray, Lord, that you will speak through him and that you will guide him with your spirit and reveal to us what it is that you want us to hear. And we thank you, Lord, for we thank you, Lord, that we can all be empowered by the Holy Spirit in the revealing of your word through Greg today. In your precious name we pray, Father. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Vicky. Now, as Vicky read that passage out, I'm sure there was some of you thinking, "Oh no, Greg's done it again. I was a week early for Mother's Day." And you're thinking, "Oh, he's done it again. Palm Sunday is next week, and we've just read that passage for Palm Sunday. What on earth is going on?" Now, it is deliberate. As we approach Easter, it's always good, isn't it, to remind us of what happened. But because we don't meet on Good Friday, if we do Palm Sunday on Palm Sunday, we never get to talk about what happened on the cross. So we've got a week early. We're doing Jesus' entry into Jerusalem today, and then we'll look at the cross next week in preparation for Easter. And all I want you to see really clearly, crystal clearly from today's passage, is Jesus is declaring to you, "I am your king. I am your king." That is what he is saying to you. Whoever you are, wherever you are, that is what Jesus is saying. "I am your king." And we're going to look at the nature of his kingship now, and the different nature of his kingship when he comes a second time. And I really want you to feel the difference, because the nature of his kingship now creates this season of salvation, the season in history of the world during which you can still switch sides, during which you can still be saved from God's wrath. There is still time, even now, today, where we can accept Jesus into our lives, that we can be saved from our rejection of God. You see, when he comes again, that season will be over. And so we want to feel the wonder of this brief season of history that we're in. You might say, brief? What, 2,000 years is brief? But in comparison to eternity, it's a really short period of time. It's tiny. We're going to feel the wonder of that. We're going to feel the wonder today of Jesus, our King. And we're going to do it by looking at a donkey and a white stallion. And that sounds a little bit odd, doesn't it? But I want you to remember that as a visual. A donkey and a white stallion. To understand the difference in the nature of Jesus' kingship now and then, a donkey and a white stallion. You see, here right at the beginning of our passage, we see Jesus, don't we? It's a familiar story, and it says in verse 2, he said to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." Jesus is going to ride a donkey. He's going to ride a donkey into Jerusalem, the city of God. Why on earth is he going to do that? Well, verse 4 gives us the reason. This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. You see, in Zechariah chapter 9, written hundreds of years before this, the prophet Zechariah spoke of the moment God's salvation would come to the people, and that he would come as king on a donkey. On a donkey. And it's amazing, isn't it, to see Jesus is not just a person entering a city, but he is very intentionally fulfilling Zechariah chapter 9, declaring that he is the humble, gentle, saving and global king. You see, the passage in Zechariah 9 talks about this salvation, this saving of this king being not just for those in Jerusalem, but for the whole world. So coming on a donkey is not just a nice bit in the story. It is massively significant that he came humbly and gently to save all people. That is what the donkey tells us. Obviously, the donkey itself doesn't tell us, but that is what him coming on a donkey tells us. Humble and gentle to save all people. As we keep going down, we see in verse 12 and 13, Jesus enters the temple and he is outraged, isn't he? He is outraged at people buying and selling, basically making a mockery of God by using the temple as a means to make money. And he overturns the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. And he says, "It is written, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are making it a den of robbers." You see, Jesus declares his kingship by riding on a donkey. And he declares his kingship by cleansing the temple. He acts out Isaiah 56 verse 7. He drives out those who are making a mockery of God in his temple. And he fulfills what God says, that his place, his people, will be called a house of prayer. A house of prayer. And in Isaiah 56, in the verses just before this one that Jesus quotes, it talks about the coming King of God. So in quoting this verse, he is again saying, hey, look, I am the coming King of Isaiah, the one who will gather the people, the one who will gather those who are lost. Isn't that awesome? That in that very act, he is fulfilling Isaiah, saying, what is my kingship like? I have come to gather those who are lost. So the donkey, what does the donkey symbolize? Humble and gentle, saving for all people. Cleansing of the temple, as he fulfills Isaiah, I have come to gather those who are lost. In verse 14, it says, the blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. It's just almost throwaway sentence, isn't it? Apart from that the chief priests get a little bit upset. But it's a very important sentence. Again, rich and deep and full of Old Testament significance. In Isaiah 35, verse 4 to 6, we see he says that he will open the eyes of the blind and the lame will leap like a deer. And in those verses, it's talking about the one who will do it, the Messiah, the Son of God, the one who will come and make payment for the people of God, that will restore, that will reconcile, that will renew the people of God. The donkey, humble and gentle, saving for all people. The cleansing of the temple to gather all those who are lost. The healing of the blind and lame fulfills Isaiah 35, that he will reconcile, he'll make recompense for all those who are separated from God. And then verses 15 and 17, do you see how he responds to the children? Bizarre, isn't it? The chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, And the children shouting in the temple courts, "Hosanna to the Son of David." They were indignant, not the children, but the chief priests. They were indignant. They were upset. They were cross. "Do you hear what these children are saying?" Jesus replied, "Yes. Have you never read? From the lips of children and infants, you, Lord, have called forth your praise." You see, they are repeating what has been said earlier in verse 9. Hosanna, save. Hosanna is save with an exclamation mark. That's what it means. It's a lovely word that we sing in songs, but it means save, exclamation mark, to the Son of David. He is the one who saves. And it is a declaration from the Old Testament of what God will do. And these children, they are declaring it. And the chief priests go, no, tell them to be quiet. Do you understand what they're saying? They are saying that you're the Messiah. And he says, yes. Yes, I am. And do you not remember what Psalm 8 says? Do you not remember that Psalm 8 says that the children will give praise, the children will glorify the coming of the Lord? It's amazing, isn't it? "How majestic is your name in all the earth," says Psalm 8, "who have displayed your splendor above the heavens. From the mouth of infants and nursing babes, you have established strength because of your adversaries." Don't miss this. Jesus receives the praise of little children and explains why the children are praising. Because he is the majestic one of heaven come to earth. So what is the nature of King Jesus? Well, as a donkey, he came on a donkey. He came on a donkey, showing he is the humble and gentle one who will save all people. He cleansed the temple, gathering those who are lost. He healed the blind and the lame, restoring, reconciling, paying recompense for those who are disconnected from the Father. And his kingship, his majesty, is declared by the children. He is the God of Psalm 8. He is the God of Isaiah 35. He is the God of Isaiah 56. He is the God of Zechariah chapter 9. There is no doubt, as Jesus enters Jerusalem, that he is the King of Kings, as he comes on a donkey. And there is no doubt of his purpose for you, for me, and for all people, that he has come to save while there is still time. He has come to save, to reconcile, to bring back, to restore those who are lost, just like me and just like you. That is the nature of his kingship. But I said there was a donkey. And I said there was a white stallion. Let's look forward to when the nature of his kingship changes. Let me read it to you from Revelation chapter 19. John says this, "And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he who was sat on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and wages war. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written on him which no one knows except himself. He is clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which are in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword, so that with it he may strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. And he treads the winepress of the fierce wrath of God the Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings, Lord of Lords." 2,000 years ago, Jesus came on a donkey, humbly and gently, to save us. To bring in and usher in a period in human history where we could be reconciled to God. That is now. But that period will come to an end. He will return. And did you notice the difference of how he will return? Now he will return The visual image of Revelation is on a white stallion. And when he comes, this period of history will be over. The period of salvation will have finished because the new creation will have dawned. The new beginning and the new start. In many ways, an exciting and amazing thing to look forward to. When the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords will be known to all people. When he will restore all that is broken, when he will deal with sin finally and ultimately. Yet today he still rides a donkey because it's not too late. Today he still offers salvation to you and to me and to those in our community. And today we have an urgent message to send out. I don't know about you, but sometimes I can sit there so complacently. Oh, it doesn't really matter. What is my part to play? Oh, do I really want to tell others about Jesus in a culture where it's really unacceptable to do that? But I must remember that he will come on a white stallion, and at that point it will be too late. And the urgency of the message is as urgent as it was 2,000 years ago, because he could come today. We just don't know. And we want to point to the King on the donkey that saves and reconciles all people, and point to the King on the white stallion who will come to bring about the new creation. And we want to do that urgently, to receive him, to live our lives in full allegiance to him. I wonder if you're sat here listening or watching this and thinking, I'm not sure if I've ever received Jesus as my king. You see, there's a difference, isn't there, to accepting a get out of jail free card as a saviour and receiving a king. By very nature of being a king, as Jesus is, he deserves our worship, our lives in obedience and following him. He saves us by his love and his mercy from the consequence of our rejection of God and calls us to follow him. Not just bank it in our back pocket, but to follow him. To follow him with all that we are, all of the time. And as Vicky so powerfully prayed, he gives us his Holy Spirit as a deposit for when he comes again. We are to receive him and to savour him and to treasure him moment by moment until either we meet him or he returns. And we are to look forward to when there will be absolute certainty in the whole cosmos who is in charge. There will be not a person on the planet that does not know who is king. There will be a moment in history, like there was a moment in history when he came on a donkey, where he will come in time, space and history on a white stallion to bring about the new kingdom. I can't wait. I cannot wait. Do you know what? Paul wrote a very powerful statement. Dave reminded us in the life group on this on Thursday, and it sat with me for the rest of the week. In Philippians chapter 1, Paul says a statement that is hard to get your head around. He says this. He says, I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will find sufficient courage so that now as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this means fruitful labour for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it's more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. That's a way to view life, isn't it? A king on a donkey. To live is Christ. To die is gain. The king on the white stallion who will restore his kingdom. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. What hope, what security, what love, what purpose. What does it look like for you then? To have King Jesus in his right place in your life. If I was to watch your life, if you were to watch mine this week, who's king? Would Jesus say, I am king of your life? Or would we all watch and go, nah, Greg, you're king of your own life? Jesus plays a bit part. Sometimes you put him in the passenger seat. Most of the time he's in the boot. I wonder if we looked at yours, where is King Jesus? He is King of Kings. He's Lord of Lords. Is he in his right place? Or is he in the boot? You see, when he's in his right place, the freedom we have, the joy we have, the purpose we have, the fulfillment we have is in him. When we're in charge of our own lives, it's a pretty frightening and topsy-turvy life, isn't it? Because that's not what we were made for. To live is Christ. And how do you view your death? I know it's a pretty painful topic at the moment, as many of us have faced the loss of loved ones very recently. And we're all very conscious of the fact that we are mortal. This last year of meeting on Zoom, whilst there's lots to celebrate, we have been faced with our mortality in a way that perhaps most of us have never been faced in our whole lifetime, haven't we? Can you, if you trust in Jesus, sit there and say today, to die is gain. It is far better to be with Christ. Do you see him that clearly? Do you have that clear a view of how awesome and wonderful your loving Saviour is that you just long to be with him? But know you stay here as long as he gives you life to live for him. So as you think about your life now and the trials and the tribulations we're going through as a community, as a country, as a globe, as we see the stats grow, as Christians, we view death differently. We do not view it with fear. We do not view it with trepidation. We do not view it as the end. We do not see our lives as a cosmic game of chance, of matter coming together and creating these fleeting moments called life. We see clearly that we're eternal beings made for the King. And that when we die, whenever that is, we will be with him. And that is better by far. Therefore, we hold to this life lightly now, not strongly. We hold to our jobs, our ambitions, our positions, our abilities or lack of them. We hold to our health and to our wealth lightly now, because it will go. It will not last. And we do that with great joy, because as Paul said, to depart and be with Christ is better by far. To live now is for him in every way. So here's a challenge as we build and approach Easter. This is what this little mini series of 3 weeks is all about. How about looking deeply at your own heart and asking yourself the question, who is my king? Who is my king? Only you and the Lord can answer that question. I can't answer it for you. Can't see the depths of your heart, your mind, or the focus of your motivations. No one can, apart from him. Who is your king? The one who rides a donkey, humble and gentle, and saves you. The one who rides a stallion, who is returning again. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. What a joy to know the King of Kings. So there you go. That's our challenge as we begin this Easter period, to make way for the King, to allow Jesus to be our King in every area, in every moment, clinging to him in all hope, in all circumstances, whatever that looks like. Let's pray. Jesus, it was an amazing moment in history when you came on the donkey, fulfilling all that had been spoken about you as being the King of Kings, the one who will save and restore. And Lord, you've done that. Lord, we're sat here today because you have saved us. And Lord, if we're sat here today and we don't know you as our Lord and Saviour, please help us by your Spirit to turn to you and accept you as King. And Father, thank you for your purpose and plan, that we're not drifting through the weeks. We're not drifting through our lives pointless. But Lord, history is going to culminate in the coming of Christ, the white stallion, bringing to end human history and beginning your new creation. Lord, it is hard to even comprehend that, but it is wonderful. Thank you. Please help us this Easter period to look deeply into our hearts, look deeply into our lives, and establish you as King. Please help us to get to the point that with Paul we can say, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. We ask that you do this in our hearts, in our minds, in our lives, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, Amen.
And what a challenge it is to look at our lives and think, who is my King? Let us pray. Father, we thank you for being the King of Kings. We thank you that you sent your Son to fulfill all of the Old Testament prophets, that Jesus would come and die for us and rise again. And Lord, we thank you that he will come again. Let that be an urgency in our lives to share you with all who we meet, so that more and more people can enter into your kingdom. Amen. Great. So as we draw to a close, we've got a few notices. So next week, the clocks are going forward, just a little reminder. So make sure you change your clocks so that you're here on time. And then we've got, as usual, our prayers on Wednesday morning at 7 a.m. So it would be great to see you there bright and early. And then we've got the ladies' coffee morning on Thursday at 9 a.m. And that one's only for the ladies, sorry, men. And then we've got some, as you heard Greg mention earlier, we've got our live Easter Day service. And from then on, we'll be meeting live here in the Baptist Church. So it would be great to see you there. Please do stay on if you'd like with a cup of coffee and to catch up in breakout rooms. It'd be great to get to talk to some of you. So yeah, we'll be moving into breakout rooms in about 2 minutes time. So that's just plenty of time to grab your tea or coffee. And also if you'd like to stay in the main session, there'll be a few people hanging around to pray. We'd love to pray with you. So if there is anything you'd like prayer for, please do just don't click the button to go into the breakout room. Stay in the main session and we'll pray with you then. Thank you.